Well, thank you very much. Can you just move that one away? Thank you. Hello, everybody, and very nice to be here in Canberra again, one of my most favourite places to live. I rode my bike up the hill this morning, and I just remembered the time I had living in Canberra, riding to work, and very different from the traffic of Sydney and the bike hatred over in that part of the world. But I'd like to thank Barbara and Jane for inviting me to give this presentation today. And thanks, Andrew, for your introduction. And thanks also to all the organisers from ACIR, from CIGAR, and from the University of Canberra for bringing us all together here. It's great to have so many people, as we know, from so many different places. Some of you I met yesterday in one of the workshops, and so I feel like we've already started to get to know each other, and I hope you're starting to do that with each other as well. Well, my charter starting off this conference, no pressure, as I was experiencing last night, is to actually provoke discussion and to get you talking. And we had organised, I think my glass of water seems to have disappeared somewhere. Or is it? Oh, it's right behind me, thank you. We had organised to have a discussion session after this. I might have to cut into that time a little bit because we're running about 20 minutes late and I've prepared a 40-minute talk, so I'm just warning you that hopefully you'll be able to keep talking for the rest of the conference. I want to just acknowledge that the ideas I'll be talking about today are coming from, at least from these two texts. One, a popular economics book that was written, co-written with Jenny Cameron and Stephen Healy and started with Julie before she died. And it's got the strange authorship as J.K. Gibson Graham, because that is the joint persona that I've published under with Julie for many years. And for the benefit of the Spanish speakers, I put the Spanish version of the book in there. It's also being translated into Korean and Finnish. Now, just go figure. Funny connection. But the other thing I'll be drawing on is this work that I've been doing with Michelle Carnegie and Catherine McKinnon and Claire Rowland and others from the International Women's Development Agency on developing a manual for community-based indicators of gender equity. And anyone that wants to know more about that can talk to me afterwards. But I'll be drawing on that a little bit in the talk. And I'll also be drawing on work that I'll reference at the end of the talk if you want to follow it up. And I'll be talking a little bit about intermixing, really, the terms. This could be contentious, I'm not sure, gender equality and gender equity. So let's not make a big deal of that. Okay, so Seeds of Change, the conference title. Let's just play around with that a bit. And I suppose I'm interested for us to ask, what kinds of seeds are we sowing? What kind of change are we anticipating or wanting to make? And are the seeds that we're sowing fit for the current climate? So this, I'm going to use this metaphor of the seeds in order to challenge and kind of provoke you to think about what the work is that you're doing, what kind of change are you making, and is it the right kind of change for the moment? And I guess I'm asking you to do this as agricultural researchers, but also as feminists. And when I'm talking about the current climate, I'm really thinking about our planetary and socio-political situation today. What I want to do is actually tell five stories. the first of them is a kind of macro story. The rest of them are very much grassroots stories. And they don't necessarily all connect, but I'm hoping that you'll be able to connect them together in your minds and in your discussions. So just to move on, first of all, the first story is the story of the great acceleration, what has been called the massive changes that have occurred in the world, at least over my lifetime, having been a baby boomer born in the 1950s, that has brought us to this moment that has now been called the Anthropocene. I'm sure many of you have come across this term, the new geological era that we're now in which human-induced climate change is shaping Earth systems. The first time in the world's history that humans have started to intervene in the operations of Earth systems. And Will Steffen from the University from ANU and his colleagues have compiled a range of graphs that illustrate, I think, the magnitude of the issue that we're, and the story really, that we're embedded in at the moment. It shows this huge acceleration from 1950 of indicators of both socioeconomic trends, but also Earth system trends. And you can see these graphs have been compiled from data coming right back to the beginnings of industrialization from 1750. But you'll see the exponential growth rate that has risen from 1950. When you see all these graphs together, I think it's quite frightening and quite scary. And it seems that the seeds that have been sown in my lifetime, the seeds that had so much promise in the post-war period, the seeds that gave rise to agricultural productivity, that gave rise to population growth, that gave rise to increasing health and so on, have had contradictory harvests. And we need to face up to that. We've had massive economic growth and population growth, but we've had all sorts of impacts then on our Earth systems that that nourish our lives. Over that time, of course, we've also seen the seeds of feminism bearing fruit. We've seen the rise of women's education. I love this picture from the old Belaya magazine showing the liberation of women through education and increased access to resources. And this has actually produced one of the turnarounds, one of the kind of, I suppose, hopeful moments when you think about the Great Acceleration. It's not exactly shown in those population figures, but we have reached a point in which fertility decline is starting to occur globally. So the population growth that has featured massively since 1950 is starting to turn around and is starting to shift. Demographers like to attach that all to rising GDP. I'd like to also say that feminism's played some role. And certainly girls' education, and in places like Kerala, where you haven't seen huge economic growth, but you've seen massive girls' education, there's been replacement, below replacement population growth for many, many years. Okay, Peter MacDonald, take that. Anyway, they like to pin it all on one thing. But, of course, the other seeds that have been sown were seeds that I think agricultural researchers have played a major role in the whole Green Revolution, the whole rising of different kinds of agricultural productivity, which has undoubtedly produced some of the solutions to global hunger, but certainly not all of them, but has also produced incredible taxing of our world systems, species loss, decline of fertility, and so on. And along with this, of course, people like Piketty have shown that there's increasing economic disparities. There's still large populations that are hungry. We've got what Raj Patel talks about, the stuffed and the starved, and most of us are on the stuffed end of that continuum. So to some extent, we've got this threatened habitat that we're living in. Economy and environment have been separated out in such a way that the connections between them have been ignored until now, when we're really faced with doing something about this. So the question is, how do we go on? And Val Plumwood, a wonderful eco-philosopher, feminist, who was also based at ANU before she died, wrote this wonderful statement, I think, that's guided my thinking for many years now. If our species does not survive the ecological crisis, it'll probably be due to our failure to imagine and work out new ways to live with the Earth, to rework ourselves and our high-energy, high-consumption and hyper-instrumental societies adaptively. She says, we'll go on in a different mode of humanity, or not at all. So I suppose I'm interested in us thinking about, can we sow the seeds of this different kind of humanity? Can rural areas in the world, still 50% of the world's population are living in rural areas, can they be places where we can generate dignified agricultural livelihoods, where there's material well-being, where there's gender equity and sustainable environmental interactions? And of course, we have to. We have to. So the question is, how? So what I want to do is go to some bottom-up stories from that big picture. The next four stories, I'll be enrolling the voices of people across the region and in research that's been done by myself and past students of mine and others, some of it supported by ACIR and some of it supported by AusAid before it was disbanded, and also the International Women's Development Agency, two of the stories are about creating gender equity, and two of them are more explicitly about building what I'll call community economies and challenging some of the assumed dominance of a kind of business as usual economic thinking. So the first one is a story that's called The Floating Coconut. And those of you who were here yesterday in the workshop will know what I'm talking about. This is a tool that we have developed in our community economies research network in the process of trying to take back the economy for people and the planet. And it's an image of the economy as an iceberg. Originally, we used the iceberg image, but increasingly in the Pacific, we've used the floating coconut, which shows the formal economy above the waterline, the kind of visible economic indicators, you know, commodity exchange, wage, labour, mainstream business, the kinds of things that most economic theory focuses on and economic projections and economic development focuses on. Underneath the waterline are people who are excluded from this tip and seem, but who are still, of course, creating economic well-being, and their activities are often invisible. And what I want to do is show a small video clip that illustrates the use of this floating coconut in work in the Pacific. And this has been produced by International Women's Development Agency.
These are good tools to use in our communities because they speak for themselves, yeah? Not us saying, this is what you do, but it's the community men, the community women that actually put up what their experiences in the community, and based on that, they themselves will see too for themselves that, oh, now it's true. And it's not the women coming to us and talking about it, but it's the men.
This session really gives us very clear and very simple. You don't have to have any educated person to come and explain it to you.
It floats, the coconut floats. You only see the surface of it on top of the water. You don't actually see what's underneath the water. But the hidden part of all the responsibilities that has been done in the community are underneath the water. So when we mentioned that, and when we took that through the CBSEs, we can see what work the women are doing. We can see what work the disabilities are doing. And putting that on the table, we can see that every work that has been done by women and men and disabilities are very valuable. So everyone is important in the society.
The focus is always the formal, without realizing that all the informal things are mostly things that contribute to the home, and sad, it's most of the time people don't see. This is where most homes take. The argument starts in the home from all these issues. The men who have all these formal jobs, usually they look at their wife as they're not doing anything. They are like good for nothing. So I believe this really needs to go down there in the community. It will really help the men, especially, the men, yeah? To change the mindsets.
If men coming up and leading out, advocate for this, it will be just, yes, yeah, we have never seen that before. Mm. I think it's just the right timing that we started to look at ways of how can we empower our women.
This floating coconut thing. I went back home, had a thought about it, and there was this women and this men sitting outside our house. My father and my mother was also including me and my wife. And I said, guys, can we do an activity? I would like to ask your suggestions about what you think you did from Monday last week till Sunday. And they said, what do you mean? I said, just write down basically if it's a formal kind of activity, an informal one, or a non-cash economy kind of activity. So I shared those stickers with them. They wrote everything down and they stick it up on the paper and they looked at it. And I said, males, can I ask you one question? Can you look at the stickers? Your stickers are green. Can you look at it? How many stickers do you have there? And they said, there were 14. And I said, yes. Females, how many stickers do you have there? And they were like, I forgot the figure, but I guess it's 50 something. So I said, now we males usually come back from work and we usually complain, where you have you did the dishes, where's my food and stuff like that. But now you guys come and see for yourself. These are the jobs that these women had been engaged, and yet you claim and tell your wife she's a housewife. You said she's a housewife, like if she's doing nothing. But can you just imagine 56 items on the list and you did 4 or 14? That's numerous. Yeah, that's really, really impressive. So you should be thankful that your wife or your cousin sister's there. You guys should be happy. So women deserve praise and they should be treated equally as men. Mm. Exactly.
Okay. I think you got the picture there that the floating coconut is just a device that helps people see all the different things that make up an economy. It's also something I think that can be used to enroll men into the debate around gender equality, and that's something that's very important, I think, to get men on side. And of course, it allows for discussions around what is going to be equal between men and women. And it's from the basis of that kind of work that we in Melanesia work to generate indicators of gender equity around women's economic empowerment, women's coming up, household togetherness, which was really talking about how men and women think about these things and what happens when women gets more economic autonomy. How does that get negotiated in households? Women's collective action, which is very important in the Pacific, but as you'll see elsewhere as well. And then questions around leadership and say and role modelling. So these are some of the indicators that people were interested in pursuing and measuring and working with in the communities that we worked in. And of course, the implications for agriculture of this kind of work is to show that women's heavy burden of unpaid labour often prevents them from participating in things like farmer education programs. And the lack of recognition of women's role and particularly their right to any kind of economic benefit from agriculture can lead to lower productivity. So the next story I want to tell is a story that talks about gender equity, and it's based on some research that I did with Gina Kosbersky and George Curry almost 20 years ago now in Papua New Guinea. It was funded through the ACIR research program. And it's a story really about women coming up, this whole idea of a women's economic, realising some economic benefit from the work they do. And it was situated in the oil palm growing regions of Papua New Guinea. And this is a picture of a typical smallholder. This industry is an export commodity industry, farmed largely by smallholders who then harvest their oil palm bunches, and they get picked up by the local mill, which is a major multinational corporation. And some of these areas have been some of the wealthiest areas in Papua New Guinea, in the sense that wealth has generated and filtered down to these communities. But this this smallholder agricultural sector is one where women were playing very little role in the harvesting of the oil palm. The payment for the harvest, if women were involved, rarely came to them. There was this sense in which it was the men's money, and the men rarely passed it on to women. And this is a picture from one of the kind of flashcards that we've used in community discussions to think about how wealth is distributed in families. So, of course, women were very much less inclined to help out in these farms. And there was a low recovery rate, especially of the most oil-rich seeds of the oil palm, which are the ones that drop to the ground and don't stay on the bunches. So a very interesting agricultural extension officer associated with the industry thought that maybe there was a way in which we could enroll women in this agricultural harvesting process if they were paid separately rather than were relying on the family to get a salary and then distribute it to women. So they introduced what was called the loose fruit mama card, and you can see the red card on the right there. What happened was when the farmers brought their oil palm crop to the harvest, to the roadside to be picked up, the women would have a separate place to put what they called the loose fruit, the probably most oil-rich fruits. And they would be paid separately on a separate card. It was a very simple move for the company to have two different payment systems, a very simple strategy that overnight was able to change the kind of access that women had to income from this agricultural pursuit. And of course, as we know, when women have money, they spend it on school fees, on food, on mattresses, on saucepans, on things around the household, and less likely to be gambling it or drinking it or doing other things. So this is one example of a bottom-up strategy that actually was led by a corporate or an intervention that a company was able to make that improved women's monetary income straight away. Of course, it was improving the relationship of these groups to a major export commodity in the kind of formal market. And of course, it's a kind of agricultural commodity that is much maligned around the Pacific and Asia now, and we really need to be questioning, you know, are we the stuff because of the amount of oil palm oils in our food or in our cosmetics or whatever? What is the supply chain or the demand chain that's creating this demand for this kind of work that's having major impacts on some of those indicators of Earth systems? But nevertheless, that's one story of a bottom-up process of increasing gender equity. And just on that issue, I think there's been some very interesting research then on what happens when women get access to income, but also how they've been denied access to the information they need to become more involved in mainstream farming. And Michelle Carnegie and a whole lot of colleagues have been working in Myanmar, again on an ACIR project, on this whole relationship of getting more women involved into the farmer group education system so they can take a role in knowing about the technological changes that the men are starting to introduce. And often this is because women in Myanmar, for instance, are actually in charge of the purse strings in the household, and they're reluctant to give money to the husbands. It's almost a reverse here, to pay for extra gypsum or whatever for the farm unless they understand why. So this has been a very interesting project, kind of building on this idea that comes out of our other research on trying to work with men and women together in understanding what's going on in the farm and enrolling women in that communication process. So I want to move to another story then, that's a different one, and it's really a story about women's collective action. And this is a story that is sowing the seeds of what I'd call economic diversity. It's coming out of research that was done a number of years ago in the Philippines, where we were involved in an action research project to develop community enterprises. And it's a project that was, or an intervention that was led by older women. So some of the women that are still working as farmers in the community, and this, they got involved in value adding to an agricultural commodity. So I'll have another story to show you by film. To the, oopsie.
basic food, but not to cash income. So they wanted to have a regular cash income, but they don't have the idea on how to start a community enterprise. So we help them do the research themselves on business feasibility. We help them do the market study in the local market of Hagna. So they all walk from Laka to the town proper, which is about 4.5 kilometers, and they talk to people along the way and to the stall owners in the town. And they were surprised to find out that there is a great potential of this salabat. So they went back home and they are very enthusiastic in starting right away producing ginger or the salabat. Starting with what they had, they negotiated the use of this barangay hall as their temporary production site. The Laka Ginger Group makes sure that what they are processing is of good quality, fresh ginger. So they sort it out first before washing it under running water. The clean ginger is pounded and be added with water. The pounded ginger with water will be pressed to get the juice, which will be added with sugar, which the ratio is perfected through research and development. The mixture of sugar plus the juice of ginger will be strained to make sure that it is free of solids. Now it is boiled until it becomes powder in form, which is called salabat. The salabat is allowed to cool down before packing, but it is also being pulverized before packing. And that's it. The packed salabat is ready to be marketed.
It's interesting to see how this group have incorporated local work traditions that are respected and understood into their community enterprise. Maureen, can you tell us a bit more about this?
Yeah, well, for example, if one of the members is sick, so she will send someone in her family in her place, and then that is basically what we call humus, or the reciprocal sharing practice in local agriculture. The members also share their food, so they bring in food and other goods to share with the other members during lunchtime, which is also happening like in the ordinary interaction in the community. That is also happening in the farming, like during planting and harvesting season. Aside from those in their marketing, they established the suki system, where the seller is establishing a relationship with the buyer, which is unlike the ordinary one, like the exchange of goods with the cash. They have some practices that will ensure that the customers will always buy their product. For example, giving them discounts or leaving the product and just come back later and get the payment. So also the group is setting aside some percent, 10% of the enterprise income is a cash standing, so that if any members will need money, they can just go and ask without interest. It is basically built on trust. In terms of the future, the Laka Group is trying to maintain the quality of their product. They are also making sure that they can supply the local market before stepping into the bigger market, or the national and international. They are also building an appropriate processing plant so that they can move out from the temporary barangay hall. And they were developing new products, such as the sugarless ginger tea for diabetics.
So, ano na nakaingon man mo nga kining atong gihimo pang komunidad nga negosyo?
Para sa aong opinion, parang nako, mahita po good aning among gihimong livelihood. Dili lang kay usa ka tawo ang na-benefited, kundi ang tibuok komunidad nga sa amo pong gipaning kamutan nga sa ngadto-ngadto dili lang kay ang karon ra nga mga katawhan namo may ma-benefited hantud ang among mga sunod pa mga generation nga dili na mo ngadto sa laing lugar para manarbaho.
Ikaw lang.
Nakakwarta mi o ang laing o ang dinhi sa among barangay, dili lang kadinhi lang kung dili at tupod sa laing barangay nakatabang sa o kanang labi na kining sa Luya.
Oh, isa po. Bakit?
Oh, ako tigpalit din para makakuan din.
Mi, gipalit na kasi yung host. Sa alpong panglawas, doktor mo po gibayad. Dako ko na, nagpasalamat kasi ko nga kami nakatukod o ingunan.
Hmm. Ikaw na.
Ang saan po? Nakahimo mo naani, gumikan sa mong pagpaningkamot na makahimo gabi aning ginger. Unya, nakakatun ko sa akong mga customer gumikan sa akong pagpasabot nila nga mo na mapalit ka mo sa among produkto kay maayo kinis at panglawas.
Na ako meeting kasi mo
nakakita na gid ko ba daghang mga customer na ko yan
si na Marina.
Ako sekad karon murag nalipay tungod sa among pag marketing daghan naming customer ba nga among pag atubangon di namin mauwaw kay naanad naman mi nana tungod sa among produkto dinhi sa barangay sa Laka. Maras at ko ya.
And
see, ako, bisag tigulang na na-entrabi hapon, mao'y rimitanan sa naanaghalin sa produkto. Nakatabang ko na mo. Mulitira man tako di, padayong.
Sige.
Salamat.
My team and I Okay, so I think you can see then from that story the way in which the group were able to enroll all sorts of diverse economic practices that were already part of the agricultural community to come together to build this small community enterprise. And you can also see the form of psychological and emotional empowerment they got from being involved in this, moving out of their very local area out to talk to other people to generate a market, for instance. And what was so key to this process was the fact that it was community researchers that made it happen. That they were the ones that took the process out and made it come to fruition. So, and these are just some of the diverse economic practices that we documented in this Filipino community. Again, all these very interesting transactions and forms of labour that have their own language that I think we talked about yesterday. Many of these languages are being lost to people, and yet they are the kind of economic assets that communities have to work with, especially if they're trying to build a different kind of economic development that is very much on the ground based on the needs of the community. So the last story I'd want to tell, and I know the time's getting away from me, this is the story of a group of women in India in the Rayagada district of Odisha, and these women dream. They have what they call a subaltern dream of 35 Adivasi women who are single, and they're single because they're widowed, they've been abandoned. Some of them might be the kind of sole parent that we heard the Vice Chancellor talking about, whose husband has gone away for many years. So they're not necessarily single, but they in effect are single. And these women, their interest is to collectively work towards making agriculture a livable condition rather than a profitable economic system. As one of the members of the Sangatan, which is a collective they've formed, Mami Perenti says, "The land is my womb and the crop is like my growing child." For these Adivasi women, agriculture is a form of life. And through an action research collaboration with Bhavya Chitranshi, who's now doing a PhD with me at Western Sydney, but she began an action research project in 2013 as part of her Masters of Development practice from Ambedkar University in Delhi. And through that process, this Sangatan formed and started building a collective life through engaging with collective farming. And now about 130 women from surrounding villages have come to be part of this Sangatan. And I'd just like to use their words to show what they've been doing. But first of all, that really what they've been experimenting with is indigenous seed varieties. They've been trying to move away from the bought seed and start to harvest their own seed. They've been interested in moving towards more ecologically sensitive methods and techniques, activating, as they say, logics of nurturance, sharing, co-labouring, co-dependence with each other and with earth others. So here they're recognising the kind of communities that exist in the soil, in the forest, in the vegetation. And they're reframing what it means as well to be single in India, in Indian society, taking back that notion of singleness as something that they can embrace, and as they say, making time for themselves. And I've just included there a kind of an iceberg image of seeds that's been that was put together by Laura Gutierrez Escobar, who actually was doing a course with Arturo Escobar, the post-development scholar, and started to use the diverse economies idea to try and map out the different kinds of seeds that communities have access to and some of the issues associated with that. So just some of the words of the members of the Sangatan. From one, we in the Ekanari Sangatan wish to live on our land surrounded by the forest and a river where we would labour together to produce and share the food, look after each other, sing and dance in harmony, and where we shall be free of all our pain and misery. In the words of another, attending to each other's pain, providing each other emotional and financial support, looking after one another in times of difficulty, despair and illness. We also laugh, sing and work together, creating moments of joy and happiness every time we meet. And as Bhavya has written, they've also said, when we work together, the work feels so easy. It becomes difficult, both physically and psychologically, when we have no one to share it with. Since 2013, they've experimented with different kinds of farming techniques, and in 2018-19, the collective farming group has used the preserved indigenous seeds from the last year that they've harvested, and here they're collecting those seeds together. No high-yielding seed varieties have been planted, and they've used neem as a kind of soil conditioner instead of artificial chemical inputs. The Sangatan is experimenting with random sowing now and with line sowing. They're kind of doing their own kind of experiments. And the seeds that they've generated have been shared with farmers in nearby villages, and they too are starting to experiment on small plots. So it's a very different vision of agriculture as a form of life and agriculture as a form of emergence, I suppose, of a different kind of sensibility for these women. Okay, so let me just wrap up. I guess I'm interested in, as I said at the beginning, what are the seeds that we're sowing and what change are we making? As I said, and as we know, 50% of the world still lives in rural areas. Agricultural livelihoods predominate in those areas. We as agricultural researchers work with people, and I think we need to be working with people to go on in a kind of different mode of humanity. The stories that I've told are really stories about first challenging the challenge that we're faced in the Anthropocene of repairing the damage of what has been sown in the past. We're also interested in taking back the economy for all people. And I think the third story is about women coming up in a relatively business-as-usual world, which is going to still happen and needs to happen. But the fourth story was about women's collective action in building a different kind of community economy. And the last story was about, I think, what we could call some kind of transformative action where agriculture is being seen in a different way as a form of life, as a form of interaction with earth, and in this case, singleness, is seen as a state of emergence. And I'm hoping that those thoughts might provoke some thinking in you and discussion over the next few days. And those thoughts are coming out of the work of the Community Economies Collective, where we're interested in new languages of economy and imagining and enacting collective actions that diversify the economy, just in the way we're told that diverse ecologies are more sustainable and resilient. So I think are diverse economies. And identifying ethical economic practices that we can build on and ethical economic subjects, starting where we are, which I think I've tried to illustrate. So when I think about gender equity, this is the image that we came up with in the Pacific, thinking about the kind of river of change where different kinds of indicators and interactions might increase gender equity, but perhaps that river of change is also something we can join in on to create this different mode of humanity that Val Plumwood was saying we really need to be engaged with in the next generation or so. So thank you very much. These are some of the references if anyone would like to follow up on that research. And thank you for your patience and interest.
Thank you very much, Katherine. That was fascinating, both real-world examples from, as you said, the grassroots, community level, but also within the context of some fundamental rethinking of the way in which our world is organised. I think Anne and Co, you're going to facilitate a broader discussion in the whole group, so I'll leave it to you.
Before, I'd just like to give a small thank you gift on behalf of the organisers.
Absolutely. Thanks again, Katherine. So this session's going to go for 15 minutes. No. Okay. So we're going to do this for 15 minutes, Barbara. Is that right? And then, and then the big group selfie. So if you get lost at any stage, look for one of these folk in the lime green t-shirts. They'll tell you where to go.
Thank you, Andrew and Barbara. And I'd just like to say thanks again to Katherine for sowing the seeds of a different kind of humanity and helping us think through what worlds we want to grow and harvest. A lovely metaphor to think about ourselves being part of the river of change. So I'm Anne Hill from the Australian Institute of Sustainable Communities here at UC, and together with Ewan Laborg from CGIAR, we were tasked with allowing for some kind of guided discussion following today and tomorrow morning's keynote. And because we've only got 15 minutes, I'm pretty confident we'll be able to have some rich dialogue and then also still hear a few of your reflections from your discussion, because it's really important to have the chance to digest the content and internalise it and think about our own experiences. I have had the great pleasure of working closely with Katherine over the last 15 years, and one of the papers that we got to write recently from an Australian Research Council project we've worked on is one that has given us this wonderful quote that connects with much of what Katherine was saying, but also with the conference theme. Seeds have the potential to be both a grounded connection to place and a microcosm of relationality, connection, and exchange. They spring literally from a place and are made by, and with the soil, the planting practices, the social norms of harvest, and seed selection used down to the very valley and field that will make and remake the seed. So in this session, we wanted to give you the opportunity to think about this question. What seeds of ideas did this keynote help to sprout for you specifically for the communities and places in which you work? So in the next 10 minutes, we'd like you to turn to two other people sitting around you and perhaps just focus on the first dot point in the interest of using the time well. So sharing an idea from the keynote that you can already see taking root or yielding some kind of plentiful output in the places where you live and work. So I'll bring you all back together in about 10 minutes and we'll just hear a few reflections from you. So just find two other people. If you can turn yourselves to find two people just right where you are, that would be great. Thanks. Okay, last idea.
Thanks, darling. I'll get Jane to you sign. You see sign, so I just need to get over the
road. Oh, fantastic. Okay, thanks very much, everyone. If you could all just come back to the shared space. Thank you. In the interest of going out to have our wonderful group photo, I'd just like to ask you all to come back to the shared space of this room. Thanks. So we're going to just gather you and maybe three or four comments. We've probably got time to hear three or four comments. If you could keep them to quite brief for the benefit of everybody in the room having a turn. Thanks.
Oh, thanks. Peter Wynn's my name, from Uni Melbourne. Very interesting talks, but there are two things that were left out of the discussion, I feel. All of those examples associated with interaction with women and women's groups, and men for that matter, but the school kids were forgotten, and the education process must start with the young community. The second point is religion. Religion plays an important role in how tasks within a community are dictated, and yet I didn't see the word religion up there anywhere, and I'd just like to promote a bit of discussion on that. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. This was a powerful presentation. And what we have learned from our group is that we cannot understand women's potential unless we give them space to tell their stories, but also perform and help us recognize what they are doing in real life. Thank you.
In our group, we just make a very good decision, like we can have an activity with the male farmers and the women, and making them realize the male farmers the better understanding what the gender is playing role in the agriculture and the livestock. But I just want to ask if you just talk about the collective actions and the group marketing of the female farmers. Did you face any challenges about that component? Because this is very hard to engage the farmers in a group and having the group marketing. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Good morning, everybody. Alessandra Gallia from ILRI. Thank you so much for the inspiring words. We were discussing it. One thing that I was thinking of when looking at the presentation is that the type of development that we are supporting, particularly in the CG, is a very much access to markets. And the question is really, is that what we are doing? Are we just trying to push everybody to go into markets and make money? Or is there a different model of development that we could support? And I think that the reference to ethical economic practices and agriculture as a form of life maybe talks to that, and I wanted to hear a bit more about it. Thank you.
Do you have another reaction? Hi, I just, my name's Anne-Marie, and I shot that floating coconut video. And I just wanted to answer Peter's question to say that, in fact, churches were used very heavily in that water sanitation and hygiene project that the floating coconut comments came from, and also youth were engaged in that project in the community. So it was a full community transformation sort of project. But that specific section was just about looking at the floating coconut as a tool rather than the whole project. But I can point you at the videos for the larger project if you'd like to see those. Great video.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm Annette Mulema from ILRI Addis. We had a discussion here and we're reflecting about what we've done in the past, the good we've done in the past, and how we can bring that to scale. Because many projects have done similar approaches, or they've implemented the same. but we've not returned to the, we have not gotten to the point where we say actually we've made impact at scale. So how can we bring this to scale? And then the issue of politics, we thought that was kind of a missing gap. What happens at the lower level and then at a higher level? So how can we connect what is happening at the lower level and then the higher level? And then the influence of the multinational companies, the businesses, private sector, the implications on these small scale businesses. How can we address that?
Thank you very much, everyone, for your thoughts and contributions. We're going to keep thinking as we move through the conference, keep sharing your ideas and sowing seeds and thinking about the kind of world you want to bring into being through that. We're going to move from here outside for the photo, and then I gather morning tea is a little bit on the run this morning, so you can keep talking to people as you move into the first session. Okay, thanks very much.